Finally, on these seven thoughts of leadership, now Peter Senge brings insightful thoughts on generative learning or generative thinking, where he juxtaposes adaptive thinking and generating ideas. Mm. So as a leader, how do you encourage them to generate ideas in their everyday business? It's not about sitting on the laurels anymore. Now the world is changing so fast. You look at AI is coming very fast. You look at automation, you look at 5G, I always talk about 5G. It shows that someone should be thinking on how to generate the next bounce of the ball.
I think that it's about time horizon, right? I think the reason most leaders don't shift, don't change, don't move fast enough is because most leaders have the wrong time horizon. Mm-hmm. So let's take a step back. If I'm a middle manager in an insurance company today, it's likely that I've been in that insurance company for minimum 7 years, most likely 10 to 12 years. And in that period, I can name the number of things I've seen actively disrupt my job. And they're very few and far between. So when you come and talk to me about these innovations that are going to disrupt my job, my reference point is my personal experience. And that is to say, if I haven't experienced those things, then I hear you, but I don't hear you.
Yeah.
So the cost of making the change is not worth paying because there's no pain point. Human beings, and if you study now the world's seminal work by the economist whose name escapes me, who penned the first piece of literature on behavioral economics, okay. What he talks to in that particular thesis is the simple idea that human beings are driven by reward, read pain or pleasure. It's that simple. And so if you're a business leader and you want to understand why people aren't shifting or changing, it's either because there isn't enough pain to, or there's not enough gain, there's no pleasure. So most of us going, I mean, we have this conversation, you know, the world is changing, 5G is coming, robotics, AI, yeah, but tomorrow when I get to work, my emails are still going to work, you know, the board meeting is going to be the same, my shareholders are going to ask me for the same stuff. I hear you, but it's not translating to my lived reality right now. And that is true, you know, I mean, you know, for the world's largest carriage, you know, operators, cars didn't exactly disrupt their businesses right now. You know, for fixed mobile telecommunications companies, you know, mobile telephony didn't disrupt their business right now. For many of the pay-to-play digital television platforms, content operators like Netflix and Hulu, that didn't disrupt their business right now. It doesn't have to disrupt your business right now. And that's the problem, is that business leaders frame it and go, yeah, but you know, it doesn't affect me right now. The current leader of Unilever did something interesting when he took over. He stopped doing quarterly sales announcements to analysts. Now, when you're listed stock, analysts need quarterly guidance from you about how your business is going to perform. And he stopped doing it. Something very interesting happened. When he stopped doing it, the Unilever share price started trading at a discount of NAV. The finance people understand that. In effect, what the market was saying was that the business is less, worth less, than you would get for it if you closed the business down today and sold all of the assets and paid off the liabilities. Basically, every day you're running the business, you're eroding value, not creating value. If you run a business that trades at a discount of NAV, it's a perilously dangerous situation for a CEO because it invites hostile takeovers. I'll give you an example. You have R3 worth of assets, $3 worth of assets, and $1 worth of liabilities. Your net asset value, NAV, is $2, but your share price is trading at $1.80.
Yeah.
So something's wrong here. So it's easy for me as a private equity operator, as a hedge fund, to go to the market and say, this stock is trading at a discount of NAV, give me $2, and I will buy the stock for $1.80, and I will get it to trade at $2.50. A good business should trade at a premium of NAV, not a discount. Because the net asset value is the assets. Above that, you have the management team, the strategy, the competencies, all of those should build into the value of the business. Right? So anyway, he does this. And the share price trades at a discount of NAV. Warren Buffett, who at the time was with the Kraft and Heinz crew, went and made an offer. It was an unsolicited bid. The great Bloomberg English is it's an unsolicited bid. The correct English is it's a hostile takeover. And they made an unsolicited bid for Unilever. And the story is told like a fable. The board called a meeting and the CEO had to go and present. And he's sitting with a group of board members, some of whom are for the takeover, others who are not. And they said to him, "What would you advise us as the CEO?" And he said this. He said, "As an organization, we can either build a business for billions of people or a business for billionaires. We can't do both. So if we go the quarterly announcements, short-term market commitments, we're building a business for billionaires, because who's worried about quarter-on-quarter performance? Billionaires that own hedge funds that own your shares. But if we want to build a business that's going to add value to poor communities in Punjab, if we want to build a business that's going to create new products for Libreville in Africa, if we want to build a business that's going to create a new product for Colombia, we can't be worried about a quarter-on-quarter performance. We've got to take a long-term view. That's a business for the billions." He said, "I'm the CEO that's building a business for the billions. That's why I don't do, what's the point of doing quarterly sales announcements? We're going to try something new today and it's going to fail. And now I have to tell the analysts it failed. Judge me on a 5-year term and see what I've delivered." And it's interesting to watch what's happened with that share price and how it's come back up. So the point about it is the disruption doesn't happen immediately. It never does. But if you wait for the disruption to happen, you'll be caught flat-footed, as they say in boxing, and then there's no opportunity to respond. We'll be right back.